Okay, so I guess we can get started. Hi everyone. I'm Zhiting, a guest lecturer today. I'm a PhD student in the machine learning department. Today, we'll be talking about DeepSeek's sequence models. So let me first give you a high-level overview of this section of this course, right? Deep learning and generative models. So in the past, three classes, we have been talked about the foundations of deep learning, right? In the perspective of deep probabilistic graphical models, and we had two lectures, right, about basically deep generative models, in which we have been focusing on the inference and the learning algorithms. Today we'll be talking about essentially the model architectures. How these deep generative models and other deep learning models are composed with basic deep learning building blocks. And then in the next lecture, we'll give a unified view of these deep generative models. So today, on the outline, we'll be talking about four fundamental and very popular model architectures, including the convolutional networks, recurrent networks, and the attention mechanisms. And the last one is the transformer, which is essentially a kind of a specialized form of attention mechanisms. Okay, so let's first go to the first part, convolutional networks. I'm gonna give a very quick and very basic level introduction of all these architectures. So convolutional networks are basically inspired from our biology, right? These are kind of biologically inspired variants of MLP, which is the multiple layer perception, right? So here, this is the MLP or fully connected neural networks. So given an input, like an image, each neuron, right, in the neural layer will be connected to every pixel in the input image. So this is fully connected. But in convolutional networks, so we have the concept of our receptive field. So here, each neuron, right, in a convolutional network will has a kind of receptive field, right, is connected to a local region of the input image, right? And so these cells or neurons are sensitive to small subregions of the visual field. Right. And we basically call this cell or a neuron as a local filters. And these subregions, right, are tailed to cover the entire visual field or the entire input image. So on the basic properties of convolutional networks, basically it has a sparse connectivity. Each neuron is connected to a subset of neurons from the preceding layer. And here, this neuron, right, is connected to three neurons in the last layer. And the weights are basically shared. This link kind of share the weights with these two links. So we can see these three links, right, red, black, and green, are basically kind of a filter, right? And we kind of use this filter to traverse the whole input image so that you get the local features, right, of the whole image. And with increase and at higher level, right, we basically get increasingly global receptive fields because this neuron basically receive information from all the input neurons, right, based on this hierarchical structure. So these simple cells will detect the local features, and the complex cells will pull the outputs of the simple cells. and so that it will get the full information of the input. So these are basically three properties of convolutional networks. It's pretty simple, actually. And with this hierarchical structure, right, with increasingly global receptive fields, the result is that we get a hierarchical representation learning. So this is the raw image, right, raw pixels. And at a lower level, we basically get the features like these very basic, like edges and like corners, right? And if we kind of like go deeper, we get this increasingly more abstract and higher level features of the image. Like this, we can see like more complex shapes and like textures. And if we go further, we get like higher level features. Yeah. So with this basic building block, like the convolutional layer, we see like there are a lot of like variants of this convolutional network. So at the beginning, right, 2012, we have AlexNet, which is kind of like won the first place in the ImageNet image classification competition. And then later on, we have like VGG, right, which is kind of like a much deeper than the AlexNet. And we have like GoogleNet, like 22 layers. And now the state of art is usually the ResNet, which can easily go to like hundreds of layers. And each layer basically is a convolutional layer. Yeah, so this is a very, very quick go through of convolutional networks. It's pretty simple. And basically, you just need to know about the three basic properties of the architecture. So the second part, recurrent network. Okay, so what's the difference between like convolutional networks and the recurrent networks? So convolutional networks are basically used for like spatial modeling, right? As we see, like given an image, we kind of like move the filter right across the whole image. Basically, we get the spatially local features. And the recurrent networks is different. It's for like sequence modeling. And basically here, this is a kind of like a convolutional network or whatever like feed forwards, like a fully connected network, right? Given inputs, we do this feed forward computation, right? We get the features layer by layer, right? And the output depends only on the current input, like an image. But for sequence modeling, right, yeah, this is the kind of the schema of this feed-forward computation. But for like sequence modeling, right, now the hidden layers and the outputs will additionally depend on the previous states of the hidden layers. So it's not only depends on the input, but also the state of the previous hidden layers. Like if we draw this schema, right? We basically have a loop here. And if we unroll this loop, we get something like this. Right? The input is in a form of a sequence. Right? You can imagine like this is a sentence, right? And the x0, x1, x2 are the tokens in the sentence. And we feed these tokens like one by one, right? And we compute these hidden states step by step, right? And this hidden state will depend not only on the current token of the sentence, but also the hidden state from the previous step. So this is the sequence modeling. And you can see, right, this computation steps is kind of like a variable, right, in this sequence modeling. This is different from this spatial modeling, which we have kind of like fixed the number of computational steps. Okay, so our recurrent networks can have different forms, right? Say we can see this image classification, like spatial modeling, as a special case of this sequence modeling, in which we only basically have a single step of modeling, right? This is one-to-one. And if we want to do like image captioning, right? The input is a single image, and the output is a sequence of tokens. So this is a one-to-many ARM computation. We can also do like many to one, right? Like say in sentiment classification, input is a sentence, right? A sequence of tokens, and the output is a single label, right? The sentiment label of the sentence. Or like video recognition, basically giving a sequence of video frames, we want to predict the activity presented in this video. So this is a many-to-one computation. And many-to-many, like the machine translation, given a sentence of in a source language like English, the output is another sentence like in Chinese or like Japanese. So we also call this as a sequence-to-sequence modeling, right? From a sequence to another sequence. Or like many-to-many in a different form, right? Say named entity recognition, right? Input is a sentence, and for each token in this sentence, we want to kind of like predict a label for this particular token. So in this kind of like task, the output, the length of the output is always the same as the length of the input. So for this task, we should call this as sequence tagging or sequence labeling. This is different from machine translation, right? Because here we don't know like whether the outputs, the length of the outputs will be will be the same with length of the inputs. So you can see this is slightly different. So yeah, with these different architectures, right? So how about the computation in each of the steps? So here, this is basically the computation of the of each step in the recurrent network. Here, we call each of these steps as a cell, right? We compute, in each cell, we compute, like given the input, given the hidden state from the last step, we do this computation, like we have a weight W and a tangent H and other like different computations, basically. So this is the equation of each the computation each step. But what's the problem here? So vanishing and exploding gradients in recurrent networks is basically the key like the issue of this model. So basically the issue is because like when we compute the gradients of say a particular hidden state, right, H0 say, right, this hidden state, this gradient will involve many factors of W, right? If we like we do like a gradient back propagation, right? So like from this step all the way back to this hidden state. And we based on the train rule of gradient, right? We like compute the gradient and we can see like the gradient will involve a kind of a sequence of factors of W, right? Kind of like being like multiplied together. And if the largest singular value of this W is like larger than one, we'll get the exploding gradient because you can see like if we multiply W like again and again, we get like the gradient will be get larger and larger, right? And at the end, it will basically exploding. So under if the singular value, largest singular value is like smaller than one, this gradient will get smaller and smaller and at the end close to zero. So this is basically the problem of this optimization or training of the model. For exploding gradient, a simple way is to like do like a gradient clipping. Right? If the gradient is kind of like exceeds the thresholds, we can like kind of like do the clipping. But this is kind of like for ad hoc. Say like for vanishing gradient, we don't have a effective way to like fix this issue. So this is the first standard and basic recurrent network. To address these two problems, like so another issue, right? Because of this like exploding gradient, vanishing gradients, so if the sequence is very wrong, right, the optimization of the of this step, like the early steps, will be not effective. So the problem here is like if the sequence is too long, we cannot really like effectively learn this long-term dependency because of this optimization issue. Say like in this sentence, right, we want to predict the next token. This is a kind of sequence modeling task. Given this, I live in France, right, and I know a reasonable prediction is French. Right? So this one, okay, this sequence is not very, very long, so this prediction might be not that difficult. But if the sentence is kind of longer, right, say there is an additional tokens like in France and a beautiful country, and I know, say we want to predict this, and you can see the distance from this slot to this token is much longer, right? So basically this prediction will be much harder than this prediction. Yeah, so this is the kind of a key issue in sequence modeling, how we can like effectively model this long-term dependency. Okay, so with these two issues, right, this vanishing gradient or exploding gradient and the long-term dependency are in kind of like 1997, we have a kind of a new version of a recurrent network, which is called like long short-term memory, LSTM. So this particular version of recurrent network is basically designed to like explicitly alleviate the long-term dependency problem and also the vanishing gradient problem. So this is the standard recurrent networks we have just seen. And this is the LSTM. Basically, we have a kind of like more complex cell in each step. So let's take a closer look at this particular cell. So we can see here, basically, if you see these three sigma mark here, basically they are the gate functions that make decisions of reading, writing, and resetting the information of each cell. So here, the first gate is the forget gate, which decides whether to like erase the cell, or call it reset. So the second gate is the input gate, which decides whether to like write to the cell, and the output gate decides like how much we want to reveal the cell to the output environment. So for the forget gate, right? Basically, this is the computation of the forget gate. By the way, you don't have to like remember all the computations here. I'm just trying to give you a high-level idea on the mechanism inside this particular model. So we have this on the input, right, from previous step, and the inputs of the current sequence, basically. And we compute this F kind of like the forget gate, which is a scalar, kind of controls the proportion of information we want kind of like a forget. Right. And the input gate is like given the input, right, of this step, we compute this IT, which is another scalar, controls the proportion of like information we want to write into the current cell. And this is the information like we basically want to write to the cell. And with these two, we combine these two, right? This is the information from the last step, and we kind of like wait list, right, with the forgetting kind of like a weight. So, and here this is the input weights, and this is the information we kind of like compute like in this at the current step. So we do this weighted sum of the two cell state and get the state of the current cell. Then with this information, right, CT, we use the output gate to decide like what to output from the current cell state. So OT is the third scatter, which controls the proportion of the information we want to output. Right, so we kind of multiply this scatter with the information of the cell, and HT is the information to be output and to be like fed into the next step. Okay, so with this structure, right, architecture, we can see like if we compute the gradient, right, using the train rule, right, in backpropagation, we can see like we can basically show that there is no multiplication with matrix W during the backpropagation. And there is a kind of pathway of like backpropagating the gradient all the way through the multiple steps. And in this backpropagation, we can see the only thing we multiply onto the gradient is the different values of forget gates. And because these forget gates have different values, right, this we'll see like this, we are kind of like less prone to like vanishing or exploding gradients. Yeah, so this is the kind of like high level intuition of LSTM, right? We add like different gates into the computation of each step, and we build this pathway to like a backpropagate gradient without the like multiplying W, the same W again and again. Okay, so with this basic like cells, right, the standard recurrent cell or the LSTM cell, we can compose these different architectures we have seen. Or like even further, we can compose more complex model architectures to model different types of data. Say we can have bidirectional recurrent network. So like say given a sentence, right, or like a speech, or in speech recognition, right, the input is kind of like a segment of audio signals. We can like use this bidirectional recurrent networks to like model a dependency in both directions. So this allows the hidden state to capture both the past and the future information. We can also have like a tree structured recurrent network. So this is the sequence structure or like the train structured STM. And for this tree structured, basically each hidden state will condition on both the inputs and the hidden state of arbitrarily many child units. So we basically get a tree structure. Like say for a sentence analysis, right, we may have like a passing tree of a particular sentence, and we can use a tree structure LSTM to encode the passing tree of the sentence and get the feature of the sentence. Or like we can have recurrent networks for 2D sequences. Say this is an image, right, given the pixels here. We can use like a pixel convolutional network to like do this like this modeling, right, feature extraction. Or we can use like a LSTM or recurrent network. Here, like say this is a model like organized by the rules. We like model the first rule and then the second and the third. So we model this rule by rule. Or we can have a different order of this pixel. Like this is a particular like a diagonal by STM. Right. So this particular pixel or this feature will be like depending on all the features of these pixels. Yeah, or even further, like we can have please. This one?
Yeah. Like, why you're only doing LSTM on the red on top of, like on the purple node on top of the red, but not the purple, like not the other white node that's on the bottom, right? What is the
solution? So here, so you can like take all this as the input to this particular cell. This depends on how you want to do the modeling. Yeah, so yeah, this is here. This is you can like decide like how much information you want to take like for this computation. Yeah, so for this kind of like, instead of like a predefined fixed topology of the LSTM, right, we can also have like a more flexible like graph structured LSTM. Like say for like image kind of like a segmentation. Right? So like there are different segments of the image, and each segment can be represented as a node in the graph, and we kind of like do this like feature learning, right, by traversing the whole graph, like basically. So the feature of each particular node will depend on the features of or its neighbors, basically. So the high level idea is that you can basically have whatever structure based on the type of data and based on how you want to model your particular data. Okay, so this is the second part, the convolutional network. So far, do you have any questions about the convolutional network and the recurrent networks? Okay, so let's move on to the third part, the attention mechanism. So let me first give you some examples of what do we mean by attention mechanism. So basically, with attention, right, we want to like choose which features to pay attention to when we do the prediction or generation. Say here, this is the task of image captioning, giving a input image. We want to generate a sentence which describes the activities in a particular input image. So here, given this image, right, we generate this sentence, and we can show that with attention mechanism, when we generate this particular token, like phrase B, we can see this model will be like attending to this particular region of the input image, which is where the phrase B appear in this image. And here you can see like a stop sign, right? This is the particular region we are interested in when we generate this particular token. Yeah, so this is the visualization of attention in this task, image captioning. And in text domain, right, in say machine translation, giving us input sentence, right, in English, the output is a sentence in a different language. And we know like there is a kind of like alignment between the tokens, right, of the two sentences, right? So here, like say this particular token across will essentially attend to this particular token in the source sentence, like agreement, right? So attention mechanism basically can learn this alignment between the input and the output. And why we want to add this attention? The first is that, again, as we saw, like, long-term dependency is the key issue in sequence modeling. And with this attention mechanism, we can basically like shorten the path between the output and the input. So here, this is the standard recurrent network, right? To predict this token, if the corresponding input token is here, then we can see this gradient backpropagation path is very, very long, right? You have to like model this long-term dependency. And as we see, like there is a gradient vanishing problem. But with attention mechanism, we can see like there is a pathway like from this token, output token, to this input token, right, through this attention mechanism. So we can see this path is kind of shortened like with this attention. And the second advantage is that we can get a fine-grained representation instead of a single global representation. Again, like with this example, right, machine translation. So without the attention mechanism, right, so we'll first use an encoder to get the feature of the whole sentence, right? And the whole output sequence will be dependent on this particular single hidden state, hidden vector, right, of produced by the encoder. So this is the standard recurrent network. But with attention, we can see like this particular token, right, will be will use the kind of like a more fine-grained representation defined by this attention. So and all these tokens like have a different will have a different representation, right, based on this attention. We'll see more details on this how we will compute this attention for each particular token. So anyway, here with attention we'll get the fine-grained representations. And the third advantage is that we get improved interpretability. Right? We can like visualize this attention, this basically a distribution, and see like why we'll have this particular token. Because with this visualization, we know there is a token here in the input, right, agreement. So this translation will kind of like return a token here. Okay, so with these advantages of attention mechanism, so next is how we can do this attention, how we can compute this attention in the model. So this is the kind of like the computations involved in the attention mechanism. So given the input, right, a sequence of tokens, say, we first encode each token in the input sentence into vectors. So this is the hidden states corresponding to the input sentence. And we see this as the key vectors, the keys. And when we do this generation, right, in the decoder, we decode, like say, this particular token. We see this as a query. Right? So we can see when we do this decoding, we'll perform a linear combination of these vectors. So the first step, like we use the query to compute the similarity with these key vectors. So basically, we kind of multiply this vector with these vectors one by one, and we get the similarity between these two between these vectors, right? Using the kind of like a cosine similarity, and we get these scores, which is called like alignment score. And then we do a softmax normalization to get the distribution. Right? This is the attention distribution or attention weights. And then with these attention weights, we will like compute a kind of weighted sum by summing up these vectors weighted by these attention weights and get the decoder state. So here's more details. We have these attention weights, and this is the encoder's hidden state at each step. And then we treat this on the state as the value vectors, and we compute this weighted sum to get the outputs on hidden state. So basically, we can see this as a query, key, and value system. The query is the decoder state, right? To generate this particular token, right, in outputs, we use the hidden states of this step as the query. And we use the encoder states as the keys, and we compute the similarity between the query and the keys, and get this attention weights. And then we use this encoder states again, right, as the value vectors. And then we compute the weighted sum of these value vectors, right? Weighted by these attention weights, and get this hidden state of the particular step. And then we use this step, the hidden states, as basically like we generate the token based on this hidden state. Okay, so there are three core components: query and key and values. And there are different ways to compute the similarity between the query and the key, or like we call like alignment scores, right? We can use like a cosine similarity to compute this similarity, right? Or like there are a lot of like different extensions like dot products and like scaled dot products. Right? So there are different attention mechanisms depending on like how we want to compute the alignment score or how we want to like aggregate these the value vectors either by like a weighted sum or like by other ways, basically. So the same, right? In image captioning, the input, right? The here query is still the state of the decoder, and the key now is a little bit different. Is the visual feature maps produced by the convolutional network? Right? So, like I say, these are different keys, right? Are corresponding to different regions of the input image. And again, like the value is still the same with the keys, like the visual maps. And here we can like as I mentioned, like there are different ways to do this aggregation of the value vectors. We can do like soft attention or like a hard attention. By soft attention, we do this weighted sum, right? Or by hard attention, we kind of like pick the kind of like the weight, the largest weight, and use the kind of like the corresponding feature map as the output state. So the different like our effects, like with the soft attention, we can see this visualization, right? The attention visualization is like more like a diffuse and smooth. And with this hard attention, we can see like for different tokens, the model will attend to a particular small region, a small local region in the input image, right? Okay, so for even like more complex applications, like image paragraph generation. So this is a little bit different task. Different from like image captioning, right? We want to generate a single sentence to describe the input image. Here we want to generate a whole paragraph to describe the more details of the input image. So it will basically involves like a long-term visual and language reasoning, right? Because like the output sentence is the output paragraph is very long, and you have to like model the dependencies of this long sequence. And this basically we want to like the description to be like very contentful, like to like ground these sentences on the visual features. So how do we do this? Right. So this is the model architecture of the whole system. Given the input image, we first like do this kind of segmentation or like a detection to like detect the semantic regions, right, of the whole image. And then we do like image captioning for each of the regions. So like say for this particular region, right, we generate a sentence like man holding a baseball bat. And for this purple box, we have like people playing baseball. Right, so we have like the local phrases or captions for each of the semantic regions. And then with these semantic regions and the captions, we use an attention here by attending to both the visual regions and the phrases. Right, and we basically integrate all this information into a kind of a final generator. And then this generator is a kind of hierarchical text generation. Because like here we want to generate a whole paragraph, right? We first generate the hidden state of each of the sentences in the paragraph, which kind of like control the topic of the particular sentence. And then we can, for each sentence, we generate the particular tokens, the sequence of tokens in the particular sentence. And all these sentences will like put together to like form an output paragraph. And at the end, we use like the game mechanism, right? Adversarial learning, with like sentence discriminator and like topic transition discriminator to enforce the the kind of like to get a high quality of these sentences and the topic transitions between the sentences. Yeah, so it's a kind of a multi-level adversarial learning. Yeah, so this is an example, like given this image, right? We detect these regions, and like say for this box, the big box in orange, we say like people riding a bike, right? And others like men wearing a black shirt. And then we use attention to aggregate all these building, the regions and the phrases into this output paragraph. Like say a group of people are riding bikes, right? Basically this is informed by this particular short phrase. And we can see others like he's wearing a black shirt and jeans. This is basically informed by this local phrase. Yeah, so this is an application of attention mechanism in this kind of like complex applications. Yeah, so this is the attention. So the key idea here is like it contains three components: query, key, and values. And we see like a different application of attention on like image and text tasks. So the last part, the transformer, is kind of we can basically see this as a special form of attention, which we call it as like multi-head attention. And there are different applications of this attention mechanism, like a transformer for machine translation, and the birds. I believe many of you have like heard this, the state of art text embedding model. Yeah, so for transformers, right? This basically, this model, this particular architecture, produced the state of art results, like in machine translation, like 3 years ago, and the BERT, right, for like text representation learning, and for language modeling, like GPT-2, right. These are all based on the transformer architecture or the multi-head attention architecture. So this is the architecture of transformer or like multi-head attention. So again, we'll see these three components in attention, right? These are the query, key, and the values. And you can see basically we first compute the similarity between the queries and the keys, right? In kind of like a specialized form. And then we aggregate on the values with the alignment score computed by Q and K. Right, and then we get attention. So this particular form is called like scaled dot product attention. And then with this building block, we basically replicate these building blocks for multiple times. And we call this as a multi-head attention. So one replication is one head. And we have like each replication of this attention mechanism. So we get multi-head attention. And we concatenate all these, the output weighted hidden vectors here, right? We do the concatenation. And yeah, this core component is then a component here, right, in the transformer, right? This is multi-head attention. And then we do like residual addition and like a normalization. And we do like a feed-forward computation, and again like a residual kind of computation. So these are kind of like a little bit more details here. But anyway, like the core component is the multi-head attention. Yeah. So with this particular component, right, then we use this to compose like a so-called encoder and decoder, like in machine translation. So here, given the input, right, we kind of stack these attention components, right, to get an encoder. Here, basically, for a machine translation model, right, the encoder will consist of like tens of these building blocks, like stacked. We stack these building blocks together to get an encoder, and then the same for decoder, right? We have this the same architecture for like a multi-head with a multi-head attention. Yeah, if we look close, take a closer look for the encoder right here. The attention, we call this a self-attention because here query and key and values are all the hidden state of the encoder. So it's like a basically attending to itself, right? And then for decoder here, for decoder, again, we have the self-attention with query, key, and values are set to the state of the decoder state. Yeah, and this is masked because like each token, right, at step T will attend to the previous tokens, right? It will not like attend to the future tokens. So this, the future tokens are masked, but it's, the mechanism is essentially the same. It's the same like architecture. And then we have the attention between decoder and the encoder, right? This is basically the same as we have seen in the standard attention. Basically, like the encoder state will serve as the keys and the values, and the decoder state will serve as the query. And we have less attention from the decoder to the encoder. Okay, so this is the multi-head attention implemented in the transformer for machine translation. And basically with the same architecture, we can get a text representation model, BERT. So this BERT is usually is used to like kind of extract the features of the input text. So conventionally, before BERT, right, we have like conventional word embedding methods, like a word to vector or graph. So for this kind of a conventional word embedding, we basically have a pre-trained matrix. Each row is an embedding vector of a particular word. Like say here for fox, right, it corresponds to a vector in the matrix. And this matrix is pre-trained with a large corpus of text. And for different training methods, we have different methods. We have different methods to pre-train this matrix, like word to vector or graph. But anyway, the same here is that we have a matrix, pre-trained matrix, and given, say, whatever piece of text, right, say, a Wikipedia document, we kind of like map each of the tokens into the vectors, right, based on this matrix, right. We kind of like do the table lookup. So this is the conventional word embedding. So each token will correspond to a particular vector. And the and BERT is a difference. It's not a pre-trained matrix. It's essentially a model to extract contextualized word embeddings. So here, for each token, right, in the input piece of text, the embedding of this particular token will depend on the context, like the previous tokens and the follow-up tokens in the sentence. So it's not like a conventional word embedding, right? Each token will correspond to a fixed vector. Here, each token will correspond to a factor that is determined by the context and the model. And for each layer, right, in BERT is again the standard multi-head attention, right? And we basically like treat these multi layers of encoders as a black box, the BERT model. And how do we use these BERT like to downstream tasks, right? Say we can use BERT for sentence classification. Given a sentence, right, we extract the features of the tokens, right, and we have a kind of a special token here, like a classification, and this token will again like have a hidden state, right, extracted by the BERT model, and we apply a classifier on top of this feature vector, and do this classification. And with this model, we basically, as reported, right, we get very great results, like across like 12 NLP tasks. We can see, like, for sentiment classification, we get the laziness state of art by birds, right? And basically, we get like 3 points of improvement in terms of accuracy with this new type of embedding. Yeah, so basically, so how do we train this BERT model, right? This is a very giant model. The model architecture, as we've seen, is simply a very big transformer encoder with over like a million free parameters. And to train this model, right, we used like a data set contains like billions of tokens and a collection of like free ebooks. So the training procedure is like this. The first objective is called the mask language model. The idea is that we max some percent of words from the input, and has and the model is trained to reconstruct those words from the context. So here's an example. This is the input, right? The training data. And we randomly mask like 50% of the tokens. Like here, for this token, we replace this with a mask token. And then the task here is like, given this input with mask, we train this model to like recover this particular token, right? The ground truth token. So we can see this is a classification task. Yeah, so this is the first objective used to train this BERT model. And the second objective is the so-called two-sentence task, which is to understand the relationship between sentences. So the idea here is that we concatenate two sentences from the training data. And we input these two into the model. And the task is to predict whether sentence B is like basically predict the likelihood that sentence B belongs after sentence A, right? So here we basically construct this kind of binary classification task, right, from the training data, right? And we want the model to be able to recognize whether B follows A in the original training data. Yeah, so with these two tasks, two objectives, the BERT is basically trained with like massive like computation resources. Like with four TPU pods, this can be trained like in 4 days. But if we want to like train this BERT like with our standard like GPU desktop, it will kind of like take like 100 days basically. So this is a very huge model trained on a large corpus of data, right, with massive computational power. Okay, so this is BERT. So the next is like a little bit about Texture, which is a kind of a general purpose text generation toolkit on TensorFlow and actually also on PyTorch. This tool was basically built for easy implementation of these techniques, like BERT, attention, and like machine translation, all these different tasks. The conventional word embedding on Texture, right? To implement this like word to vector or graph, we basically like say we first like load the data, right, and get a batch of data. And then like create the word embedder, right, which contains the pre-trained matrix of word vectors. And then we just like feed the data batch into the embedder and get the feature vectors, the embeddings of the tokens. And then we use the tokens like inside like input these tokens, the feature vectors into a classifier to do this classification. Right. And for this embedder, we can like basically specify like whether we want to load the word vector vector pre-train the embeddings or like a graph pre-train the embeddings. So this is the with Texa you can very easily implement this use this word embeddings. And to switch from like this conventional word embeddings to like a BERT embedding, we can create a BERT embedder, like say essentially BERT is just a transformer encoder, right? And then we load the pre-trained weight of the BERT model and then do this embedding, right? The data embed. And all the downstream codes can be kept the same, right? We feed this embeddings into the classifier and do the classification. Okay, and we want to use Texa to do sequence-to-sequence modeling, like in machine translation, say. So again, we have this, we can like get the embedder, right, and the encoder, and get the hidden state of the encoder, and to say we want to use the attention decoder for like generating the target sentence. Right, so with this decoder, we feed the inputs, the ground truth, right, of the target sentence, right, and also this encoder's feature factors are fed into this decoder, and then we use the like a softmax cross HP, which is essentially the maximum likelihood. Okay, and here we can like specify the hyperparameters of the decoder architecture, like what recurrent network cell you want to use, and how many layers, and what type of attention mechanism you want to use to do the modeling. Okay, so I guess this is pretty much in this lecture. We basically quickly went through all these four very popular model architectures in deep learning, convolutional networks for spatial modeling, recurrent networks for sequence modeling, and the attention mechanisms for like addressing the long-term dependency issues and increasing the interpretability of the modeling, and the three core components in attention mechanism, like query, key, and value, and given the extensions or variance of this mechanism based on how you compute the alignment score. Right. And for transformer, which is essentially a special form of attention called like multi-head attention, right? And this basically the state of art architecture for like a transformer for machine translation and BERT for pre-trained text representation, and the GPT-2, which I haven't really like discussed in this lecture, but is basically a pre-trained language model. Okay, this is pretty much of this lecture. Do you have any questions? Okay, cool. I'm happy to take questions offline. Thanks.